No kidding. Wow. That's not in my notes.
Science, yeah.
Wow, and the Cider's won a lot of awards. So.
He finally got a haircut.
Spoken like a true brother.
Well, I want to thank everybody for coming out today. I mean, just throughout my talk, one of the things I want to express is how important it is for people to be physically present here, to see the orchard with your own eyes, and to drink some cider that came from here, and just for everybody to be together. And I hope events like this will become more common and safer moving forward. We can do it a lot more. The title of my talk is New Historic Orchard. I think that encapsulates what I'm trying to do here and a little bit of my personal history. I kind of ran backwards. I got involved with older orchards and then decided to plant a young one that could emulate the majestic old orchards that I'd experienced as a kid and as a young adult. And then the subtitle, From Planting to Cider and Beyond, Cynthia came up with that one. And I was really attracted to the beyond part. It turns out that beyond is like one of my favorite places to go. So the prospect of going beyond that and talking to you guys a little bit more about some cultural value and aesthetics and stuff like that was really exciting to me, so I'll try to do that too. Let me introduce myself a little bit. Well, I'm Adam. I'm married. I have a wife, Elizabeth, and I have a son, Archer. And I have a daughter, Ruby, and a dog named Pearl. And then as of 3 weeks ago, I have another daughter, Ivy. So, I'm a busy guy. We're busy people.
Adam, do you want to turn us to turn the light off here?
It's up to you guys, and it's also,
I think. Well, that helps your face.
Helps my face? It depends on what film's best.
Screen looks fine.
Screen looks fine?
It's fine.
Okay. As Cynthia mentioned, I'm a research chemist. This is my Google Scholar profile. I'm sure it's not very, probably won't be very interesting to you, but we can talk about it afterwards if you want. I got into biofuels and synthetic biology, and then more recently, started doing some mathematical modeling for virus assembly, and turns out viruses are a big deal. So some of my work has become a little bit more relevant, which is kind of exciting. Kind of to outline what I want to do, first of all, nuts and bolts stuff. We're going to stop and take a break and have some more cider. So I hope you guys kept your cups. Maybe, if not, we have some more. My friend Paul, where's Paul?
He was here.
Matt might be Paul. Matthew or Paul will go around with bottles to help you out. Not yet. I'll let you know. I'm going to try to talk fast and cram like three talks. Here's Paul. Just so you know, this is the guy with the cider if you want a refill. I'm going to try to cram like three talks into one. The first one is really about historic orchards in this region. It really got me going on orchards to see the old orchards in our region. But also some autobiographical stuff, so weaved in how I came to become interested in this and the steps I took to eventually plant what you guys just saw on the hillside southeast of this farm. And then the second part, I think maybe what most people came for, is practical stuff, so more technical parameters for trying to design an orchard like that. The decisions I decided to make, the rootstocks and varieties that I planted. So we can go through that kind of step by step and kind of give you an idea of what the plan was and the kind of progress we've made, what the results are. And then the beyond part, the really fun part, is the craft aesthetic. Craft is kind of one of those things, it's like you know it when you see it. I think it's very kind of an unarticulated set of values. But it's really important to me because, you know, these culinary products that come from a farm and are designed and produced by the same people, these are described as craft. So over the past 10 years, I've really, really tried to get to the bottom of what the heck this means, this craft, and how it motivates people to participate in what I'm doing and maybe potentially to buy a cider that I produce and I bring to market. So part one, historical landscapes. Anybody want some cider? By the way, the bathroom is in the white farmhouse, before I forget to mention it, through the kitchen to the right. And please, you guys brought so much lovely food here. During the talk, don't be shy, step up, and it doesn't bother me if you get up and walk around a little bit.
Thank you.
Universal, fill my glass, please.
When I was in my early 20s, my uncle died, and my parents inherited an old property in Shelton, Washington, and on it was an old orchard. This is a photograph of that orchard, an agate from about the 50s. And I was moving back home from Berkeley, where I'd been doing some biofuel stuff. And I needed hobbies, you know. I was moving back home with my fiance. My parents had just inherited this responsibility, and they knew that I was interested in fermentation. They thought, hey, why don't you come take care of our apple trees for us? Learn how to do that. You can have the fruit. You can make wine with it. And they would have one last chore, which was probably their primary motivation. So this is a picture that I took in that orchard in 2013, approximately 80 years after its planting. And this was my first experience with orchards of any kind, really, except for, you know, those kind of fleeting experiences when I was young, where I would go to family members' house and they had apple trees and orchards, including this house when I was really little. So I learned how to maintain, how to do restorative pruning to very old, derelict apple and pear trees. I learned about the old varieties. This orchard had some cool varieties, at King of Tompkins County and Transparent, Northern Spy and Gravenstein, and some old varieties of pear. And I learned that I really liked these kinds of landscapes, and I really liked this kind of work. And I started to think that this might be a strategy for me just to thrive personally and enjoy my life and be kind of a balanced individual. Kind of the next stop on my journey, the next historic orchard I went to was Piper's Orchard in Seattle. It sounds like you guys learned about that, so I won't go into the whole story. The community group there consisted of mostly older ladies and gentlemen that knew a lot about exactly what I needed to know, which was the care and maintenance of old orchards, and maybe also a little bit about the planting of new orchards. Another shot of Piper's. And there's a beautiful Rhode Island greening tree. I kind of like it when they get scabby. This is a picture from a KUOW spot. This is Fran Clifton. She was president of the Friends of Piper's Orchard. Catherine Morrison was director of City Fruit, which is an organization you might be familiar with. Don Ricks is kind of a local legend in Seattle in the community fruit tree space. And for some reason, they invited me along because I kind of, you know, developed a really deep interest in historic orchards and the stories behind them, how they started, and especially also how they were being maintained going into the future. Piper's Orchard is the cool story because it was rediscovered and kind of replanted. So there's this historic founding of the orchard and then also a historic revitalization of the orchard. And I was really interested in both sides of that story. Around this time I started reading, there's just reams and reams of material from the National Park Service on historic orchards. And they're kind of technical, but they get into the nuts and bolts of how to recognize old orchards, how to date them, how to identify varieties, how to learn about the history of an orchard from its physical layout and the characteristics that remain after years and years have passed. So this material allows you to become kind of like an orchard detective. You can go out to orchards, you can figure out how old they are, you can try to figure out what the varieties are, what people were kind of thinking, what their motivations were, because the three or four varieties out of hundreds available that people choose kind of says a lot about them. So it's really fun to have this kind of information under your belt. And there's just these enormous documents. This is one on John Muir Historic Site. So John Muir, in the middle of his life, became involved with orchards. And then another at Jack London State Park. This orchard actually belonged to an asylum. So that was a period of the history of hospitals and prisons in this country where orchards were often used as kind of therapeutic devices to get people working on something that was wholesome and healthy. When we were in the Bay Area, we visited that Sonoma Orchard in Jack London. Jack London State Park, amazing place. Also great artifacts and architecture on Jack London's life. That's a whole other reason to go there, but the orchard was also a good reason. The National Park Service also preserves the orchard in Stehekin, Washington.
Stehekin, yeah.
Beautiful, just gorgeously inaccessible place. at the northern tip of Lake Chelan. And this was one of the first commercial orchards established in this region. It was mostly Common Delicious, which was the predecessor to Red Delicious. There's another shot of the orchard in Stehekin. Again, National Park Service documents available detailing the composition of this orchard and its history and its characteristics. So that led me on just a blitzkrieg across, you know, the whole sort of Northwest Old Apple Tree Park in Fort Vancouver, one of the oldest apple trees in the region, died recently, apparently, well over 200 years old. There's a demonstration orchard planted at Fort Vancouver. So there was an old seedling orchard, because back in these sort of exploratory times, when the Hudson Bay Company was operating on the coast, people would carry around apple pips, but there was no scion wood. There were no grafted trees that were being transported on their own roots. So people would plant apple pips and whatever popped up, maybe it was useful, maybe it wasn't. So the oldest orchards were seedling orchards. And this community group has replanted the historic seedling orchard at Fort Vancouver with seedlings. So that's kind of a nice touch, a nice nod to the way things used to be out of necessity. There's an orchard in Steilacoom, Washington. Nathaniel Orr, who's an early settler and kind of a small businessman, he planted an orchard and it's still there. There's a little museum on the site. The Puget Sound Islands and the San Juans are just riddled with orchards. There was just, I guess maybe because of the way supplies were transported around, it just made a lot more sense to grow fruit locally. So every little island would have an orchard, and a lot of them remain, and they get picked up by community groups. Again, there's this persistent interest. This is one of those historic artifacts. It's so delicate, so vulnerable, but people pick up responsibility and they take care of them. What's up with that? That's one of the things I'm interested in. Kern Park Orchard in University Place. This is kind of a younger orchard. I think it's from like the 40s. It's, you know, Macintosh and Winter Banana and Gravenstein. But it was really well cared for early in its life, established well. And then the management of this orchard is based on sort of like you adopt a tree, right? So it's not like a committee that's handling everything. There is some individual attention to individual trees by people in the community. So that's another way to structure participation in these old orchards landscapes. And then this is great. That's from Paul. I'm so terrible at taking pictures. A lot of times I have to, it's a video too. The whole time I'm exploring these historic orchard landscapes, I'm gleaning apples from them. I'm finding all these old apple trees and learning about all the old varieties, and I'm making cider. And some of the cider is not very good, and some of it's good, and some of it's amazing, right? And I meet people like Paul, who made cider for a little bit longer than me, and you know, we talk about it and we figure out how to do it better, and we do it better, and it's been years and years now. And we started to enter competitions. This is the first 3 years I entered Clint Cap, which is the biggest cider competition in North America. So that was 2017, 18, 19. Wow. And you can see that we make progress, right? We get better.
Well done.
Quality over quantity.
Yeah, that's true too. You submit the best ones. You get nice feedback from the judges. Well, it's not always nice. You get feedback from the judges too, which is valuable. My brother Matthew came on with me about halfway through this. He's become quite the orchardist himself, as I'm sure that you can tell now that you've been down there with him. My in-laws, Bert and Diane, these are my wife's parents. They're my sponsors, and they're participants in this whole scheme. I mean, I got interested in orchards, and somehow I kind of bent their attention towards this, and I managed to direct some of their resources towards a project that I couldn't have done all on my own. And they've given me just a ton of responsibility and opportunity out here to do what I've done with that hillside. And that's, yeah, just hugely indebted to Bert and Diane. So thank you very much to them. And so we started a cider company. And we're gonna start production this year from fruit from our orchard, and also from some fruit that we buy in from around Washington and Oregon to supplement. And it's called Empyrical. That name, it's Empyrical with a Y to signify the use of pears. That word, you know, it's associated with my identity as a scientist, but it's also, if you know what the meaning of empyrical is, it's a nod to sensory experience. All of this is based on sensory experience and need that feedback from people. You can't make cider based on theory. You need to give it to people to taste, and they have to tell you what they think. And they have to be honest with you, and you have to be honest with yourself. So thank you for coming and tasting my cider, and please give me some feedback on what you think about it. And so the big questions that started popping up for me as I toured the historic orchards and I made cider from the fruit I could get my hands on, was how would you create a new historic orchard that had the qualities, that had the value of the kind of old historic orchard landscapes that I'd come to be familiar with and I'd come to really like. And I kind of started putting together some hypotheses about what might be the answer to that question. You have to figure out what worked from the past. You have to do something that's very specific to a sense of place. You have to participate physically. You know, you can't, it's not just something that's designed on a piece of paper. Something has to be built with your own hands, and that's a kind of knowledge that's participatory knowledge. You have to have a story about the fruit. You can't just plant anything. It has to go somewhere. It has to interact with the community. It has to become something. It has to become a product. There has to be an engine that's driving this whole process, or else you'll just build an orchard like you built a barn that you're not going to use, and it will sit there and it will fall apart. So you have to have interaction with it. And then you have to write your history into the landscape. So all of those values and those perfect purpose-related things are sort of built into what the orchard becomes. They're built into the varieties you plant, which rootstocks you choose, where you plant it, and the spacing and everything. So that was my next project, planting this new historic orchard. So that's our first breakpoint. That's personal history and regional history. And I want to serve you guys some more cider. So I'm going to go with the Hughes Crab. Hughes crab is an old crab apple that's been known to be good for cider since like 1840 or something. So this is one of the first varieties that really fruited for us out here on this hillside.